Welcome back to the exclusive coverage of the European Masters 2014. This is the final round, back nine. We are at Järva Disc Golf Park in Stockholm, Sweden, and I've brought a repeat guest, the guy who started it all with these commentary videos on Spin TV. Simon Lazat is in the house. How you doing, Simon?
I'm doing fantastic. Just finished up the tournament yesterday, and yeah, thanks for having me again, and it's my pleasure, and thanks everybody for tuning in.
All right, we're going to get started. We're going to go on hole 10 halfway through. We've got a great back nine, lots of par fours, lots of moving action. McBeast mode goes into full effect, so let's check it out. Hole 10, par four, 205 meters. We just came off that beautiful dogleg hole nine, and two par fours in a row. What do you think about this one, Simon?
Well, after hole nine, which is a super placement hole, hole 10 is another one of those. I would say it's a little bit easier to get a birdie on than hole 9, because you just have to throw it pretty far and more or less straight, like kind of like an S curve. And if you get that sweet spot behind those two bushes you see in the fairway, then it's only like a 200 foot upshot and you should have no problems getting a birdie.
As you can see, it sets up really nicely for that right hand backhand. You just flex out the ante and you can really carry it out and get some nice distance with all these guys have the arm to do so. You're going to see Paul is going to throw a textbook shot there. That's perfect.
Yep. In this short grass, you always get extra 30 feet of a skip. And the course was just really beautiful for us all weekend. Ricky leaves it a little short there, clips the bushes, but he should have no problem from there. It's a pretty forgiving hole as long as you're in the fairway.
And KJ is going to correct off Ricky's shot, which was too low. Put it nice and high. Perfect spot. It's where you want to be. Tell us a little about what'd you throw in this hole, Simon.
Yeah, I did the same thing, just a standard backhand drive, throwing my PD2s. And yeah, I played it well. I got three birdies on it, and one time I threw it OB long. Somehow it skipped out of bounds way, way back there, and then I got an OB4. So this hole treated me pretty well.
And this is the only tough lie in the group. Nate Doss is going to have to kind of stretch out and throw a nice placement forehand, and he does so. He's going to roll right into the circle and should have a look to make that putt. KJ Nybo's placed it exactly where you want, and that's how you get up and down with a shot like that.
Yeah, perfection. You see where Paul's disc is? You can't even get much further down the fairway than this. Yeah, from there, it's as you see, it's not far anymore. It's just a straight shot. And Paul leaves a little left, but in that beast mode, he should do that with his eyes closed.
Yeah, he does leave it a little off, but just a little bit of a tester putt to make it more fun for the viewing audience, I'm sure. And this is a tough putt from Ricky. He's got to straddle out from a tree and make it from the circle's edge. How big is that?
Yeah, Ricky is known for being one of, if not the best putter in the world, and that's why he's always on top.
He's definitely showcased it this year. He's had a lot of putts go in from all over the place, and it's pretty much carried his game even when his driving has faltered, but when he's gotten both of those things on in the same tournament is when he's done really well, as he has this weekend. Paul's going to can that, and these should be a couple nice tap-ins for Nate and KJ, and we're going to move on to another par four in hole 11. Three par fours in a row, and we're going to reverse. This is going to be a dog leg left, and this is a shot where you really have to lay up off the tee.
Yeah, you can't, this is not a drive for big arms. You have to place the shot once again, and I always chose the low route here. We will see the lead card right here. They will choose the high hyzer route.
And one of the things they are trying to do is avoid the couple trees that are just inside of the line of the rough that can really mess with you if you push the hyzer too long or too short. You've really got to pick one side or the other, and that can be tricky from this positioning. Mats Löf, again, does a really good job with the landscaping here and just sculpting out these fairways that are tricky but fair. And that's the important part of fairways, in my opinion. And you're going to see all these guys taking the nice hyzer route. Like I said, it's tough to see from this angle, but it is pretty basic hyzer. You just want to get a spot where you can look at getting up and down and give yourself an opportunity.
Yeah. It's the first shot is really crucial on this hole. If you don't have a good spot, then the birdie's almost not even playable anymore.
And we talked to Eric McCabe on the last nine, and we were discussing the idea of tiger-proofing, like they had to do in golf, where they had to lengthen the holes and make more twists and turns because, you know, guys like you can throw so long. What's your opinion on taking disc golf from a par 3 to a par 4 base and having a higher par overall for the course like we have here in Yarva?
I normally really like that idea. Just making holes longer, it just really suits my game, and I like just going on the course and crushing discs. So, but for like tournament play, I don't know. I think it's cool that disc golf is different from ball golf and that we have more par 3s than par 4s. I think that's totally fine.
It definitely makes it more exciting when you see a lot of people with opportunities to birdie. It adds to the excitement factor. There's good arguments for both ways, and the good news is we're going to have enough courses where we can do both of these kind of designs. We're going to see everybody's kind of on the right side of this fairway towards the rough, and Nate's going to throw the best looking Annie shot. He's not in danger of clipping a tree, but he just leaves it a little bit short.
Yeah, tough putt right here. It's just outside the circle, it looks like, a little high.
And you can see he's had that happen to him a couple of times so far this round and just not happy about it. But as a lot of people will say, it's better to miss high than low. And a rare miss from Ricky after he hit that really nice circle's edge putt on the last hole. And here's going to be KJ for his birdie. Pure, right in the center chains. And Macbeth here is looking at a turkey, if he can hit this putt here. And still holding on to a clean sheet, no bogeys this round. And this is a tough course to go bogey free on, to throw a clean sheet. You know, what? Tell me a little bit about that.
It's definitely a course where you can easily get bogeys on. And the last round I managed to play bogey free. Didn't get a lot of birdies, unfortunately, but shot a 7 down, and I don't know, it was just a kind of clean finish for me, and I'll live with it for sure. But many, many holes, not because of OB, just because of a lot of trees and a lot of obstacles to get around to get to the basket.
And we're coming up to hole 12, and this is the one, you guys have seen it already online. KJ Naibo aced this in the second round, and I was telling him afterwards it looked like he meant to do it. The disc came in at such a perfect speed and angle, there was nothing he could do but sit in that basket. He's going to take that same tree bash destroyer, and that line is looking so pure until he just leaves it a little high and nicks that tree. You know, what's it like when you ace a hole and you have to come back, and is that in your mind? Are you confident? Are you nervous?
Oh yeah, I think it's like everyone probably knows who's thrown aces. If you go back to the hole, you obviously will take the same disc again. And just, you should have your mindset put like, why shouldn't I do it again? I've done it yesterday, so I should do it again.
And that's a great little piece of insight there. We have Ricky having a little bit of trouble off the tee on this one, leaving that a little bit low in the forehand. He's going to choose the forehand upshot again. Shouldn't be too much trouble. He has a nice touch. Not many people forehand putters. What's the precision and the technical skill required to throw nice upshots forehand?
Yeah, I never throw putter sidearm or even mid-range sidearm. And that just shows how confident Ricky is with his sidearm. It's one of his most dangerous weapons in disc golf and his putting game.
He has established himself in the last couple years as the premier sidearm player in the world, and using both to his advantage as Paul Macbeth hits a very nice putt right there for his birdie. And KJ Naibo not wanting to lose a stroke to Paul, who has him by one at this point. They tied up on hole 8, and then Macbeth took the lead by one on hole 9 when KJ bogeyed. So it's a one-stroke lead. We've got 6 to play. It's only going to get more exciting from here. Hole 13's coming up. This is one that's traditionally regarded as one of the most difficult holes on the course. Well, what are your thoughts?
My thoughts are it is definitely one of the most, if not the most difficult hole on this course. I've been playing this course I think now for 3 years, and this hole is trouble for me. You have to have a perfect straight laser shot down the middle. You see this one tree in front of that gallery, right in the middle of the fairway. That's the sweet spot. And then it's another 400 feet through a gap to the right. It's just a really, really tough, even it's a tough four to get.
And this is reminiscent of some of those longer wooded holes that you see in North Carolina. Reminds me of, this would probably be open for a North Carolina par four, but the way it kind of works left and then right again reminds me a lot of those Stan McDaniel designed holes. And you just have to play to the gap. And Nate throws a nice shot right down the center, pipes it. He's going to leave it a little bit short. He's been doing that all day. And I asked Eric this question. I'm going to ask you the same one. If you get to a tournament and you're a little off on the release or you're a little short, you know, how do you get in your mind to make those little corrections to try to get back and get in the flow of the thing?
It's all mental game. And we've played so many rounds, we've played so many tournaments that we know just if we throw up shot short, next up we just throw it a little harder. We can just adjust like really tiny movements. It's no big deal for us to adjust like from one throw to the next throw.
And how long is that, just a product of practice, or what does it take to get to that kind of level of precision with your shots?
I believe it's all practice. We've thrown millions of shots and we play almost every day, if not every day. And we go on the field, we practice our shots, we play hundreds of different courses, and we just know our arm speed, we know our discs, and it's all about practicing.
And the results speak for themselves. When you have people that can play at this level, it's awesome to watch and awesome to see the results of that work. KJ had a really tough shot off the tee, having to have the gallery move, and then didn't really have a look, just tried to make something happen and hit it right into the berm there. And this is a moment for Macbeth that he really wants to capitalize. And that's a great shot. That's exactly what he needed when he needed to do it. And he's going to look to take another stroke from KJ, putting him up two with five holes to go. Ricky's going to bring out the forehand again. And he leaves this one a little hyzer and gets a fortunate kick back out into the fairway. Well, he'll have a look for a putt. And this is a crucial moment for KJ Naibo right here. He really needs to get to the green with this one.
Yeah, Paul's more or less parked in his zone right now, so he needs that one tree he had to miss to get to the basket. And the more the guys throw here, you can tell how hard this hole is. And this is Nate's third shot. That's actually a pretty good spot to be in too, right there. I don't know how many threes were played all tournament, but I would say not more than 10.
It was definitely a difficult hole to three, and none of the guys are going to get it here as KJ just cages one. He looks to be about 45 to 50 feet out, just a little bit outside the circle. Nate had a kind of awkward stance on that upshot. That's another big putt from Ricky. It's you can't stop being amazed by the putts that he can just make go in when he needs to make them go in. Paul's got a little bit easier of a shot, but still a tester. Nice and pure. So let's talk about KJ Naibo. He's somebody that you played with more than probably some of the guys over in the U.S. have played with. He's not a name that's that well known in the States. You know, break his game down for us.
KJ goes only to the USDGC every year and actually does pretty well, but somehow people don't really know his name. And his game is, he is a super early on every tournament. He like breaks down every shot on the course. And yeah, it's pretty much the opposite of my game. I just like to go and like freestyle down the course and have fun. And he's like super professional and he just really wants to do his best. He can rip the disc miles, and his putting game, if it's on, he's gonna make all of them.
He is definitely prepared, and as you've seen, you know, throughout this entire video and any videos that you may have seen elsewhere, he always has his caddy with him, and his caddy is more of a mental coach and more of a golf style caddy, where they discuss the shot, they break it down, they make sure he's confident, and then they execute. And you can see the results. He hits all these fairways. Rarely do you find him in the rough. I think the last hole was the first time I had seen him off the fairway in two or three rounds that I was following him.
His caddy is one of his best friends, and they like travel to this course a week early and play the course 10 times and just make notes and go through it over and over until he's comfortable and just giving his best and feeling good about it.
And it follows one of my favorite quotes that I've heard most recently from the Seahawks quarterback Russell Wilson. He'll say, the separation's in the preparation. And I love that phrase, and I think it fits KJ's game so nicely. Paul leaves a upshot, you know, wide right, and that was a tough stretch from the knee, but, you know, definitely within his abilities to get it a little closer than that. This should be pretty routine for Nate Doss. Put a nice overstable putter over the trees, but he's going to leave it long, and that's going to be a tough little uphill birdie get.
Yeah, the conditions we had all week were actually pretty good, and this hole was the only one where you had a little wind trouble. It was the most open, and at that basket, at this green, also with the slope, the wind was kind of unpredictable, and I three-putted in the first round where I shot my 10 down. And yeah, that hole gave me a little hard time then, but it's all about the drive on this one. If you get where Ricky was right there, or even where Nate was, it should be a routine birdie.
And if you can get your drive there, then I'm going to bet that your rating has four digits on it, and this is a big moment for Macbeth. That's the reason he's the two-time world champ. KJ was poised to take a stroke right back from him after a flubbed upshot and just puts it right in the chains. Nate's going to leave that one a little bit short. He laughs it off, the true professional, but you can tell he's a little frustrated. His putting hasn't been as solid as he wanted. His drives were left a little bit short. He came off shooting the course record on Saturday and just couldn't quite get it together to do the same on Sunday. We're going to tap in here on hole 14. We're going to move to hole 15. You're coming off a tough stretch of holes, lots of par fours. Hole 15, how badly do you want this one?
After hole 13 and 14, which are, in my opinion, the two toughest holes on the course, hole 15 is like you just stand on that tee and that basket is right there. You just have to miss this one tree. This one tree you will like see right now what you want to miss. And it's one of those few holes on this course where you actually really want to get this birdie.
And Paul is going to hit that one tree that Simon's talking about and kick off left. He's going to have a tough putt with a ceiling and be outside of the circle. KJ's going to try to correct. Seeing an opportunity here, wants to take a stroke back. He's going to hit the same tree, unfortunately.
Yeah, that tree, you want to go from the player's view, you want to go to the right around it, or you want to go under it. Like you can see Ricky here, I think he's throwing a mid-range if I see that correctly, and he goes under the branches and he's got 20 foot.
And that should be no problem based on what he's been doing all season. Nate, there he's getting the turn you're talking about.
Yes.
Getting it wide enough that he's having no danger of hitting that tree, and that's a nice clean putt. There's no overhanging branches, so that should be pretty routine. And you can see the rain all of a sudden started to fall. The weather toyed with us all day. It got cloudy and then sunny and hot and then cloudy again. And here's some really thick drops start falling. So you wonder if he's thinking about his grip right here.
I don't think he's thinking about his grip. I think he's thinking, I'm going to make this right now.
And he definitely does. And that's what I'm talking about. That's beast mode in full effect. And you know, there's nothing you could say about that hasn't already been said.
Yeah, some guy after that putt came up to me and asked me, how do you want to beat him? I mean, KJ averaged this course, I think, at like 8.5 down per round or something around there. And if you can't beat Paul shooting on that course, that score, then I don't have an answer for that question.
So he did average 8.5 down, and Paul averaged at the end of the tournament one stroke better each round. And it's putts like that. That's the extra little bit that these guys have that's just insane to watch. It makes for great competition. But those, that one little putt can win or lose you a tournament. Nate's gonna clean up. That's gonna be almost. That is gonna be almost a star frame. KJ with the unfortunate miss, and we're gonna move on to the TV holes. So live TV. What's this do for the sport? You know, how exciting is this to go to a major and have the chance to be on a live TV broadcast?
Yeah, for disc golf, it's very fresh, very new, very exciting. And you heard Yossi actually in the background of this video say 10-minute break, or after this hole right now, 7-minute break. It's because the TV guys weren't ready yet and they were waiting for everything to clear up for the lead card. And I think we had 11 cameras, is that right?
I think so, yeah.
And like really, really professionally done. I've seen the footage already. It looks amazing. So if you have a chance to check it out, check it out.
Definitely check it out. You guys can get to it from Discmania, Spin TV, European Masters. All of our Facebook and social media sites are linking to it. You can rewatch the entire broadcast, which will show the top four men's cards and the women's lead card. So it's a great way to see just another angle and what's the future of the sport here, because they definitely have some awesome equipment and some skilled operators that makes it a lot of fun to watch. And this hole is really tricky. You actually have to get it way right, and you have an insanely elevated tee. It's impossible to get the basket from filming up by the players. You'd have to go down and film upward. You know, what's the trick here?
Well, this kind of hole, it's hard to birdie and hard to bogey. So you see Paul's drive right there. That's a really good drive. You rarely see a disc land there because it's a big slope. You can't really tell in this angle, but it's sloping down towards KJ now, so he has a big uphill putt. And it's just tough. If the basket's on a slope, it's always tough. It's a big Anheuser hole downhill, and to land the disc flat right there and have it sit, it's just not easy.
And you saw the lead card took two sidearm drives and two backhand drives, so a lot of different ways people choose to attack this hole, and only one of the guys on the lead card here is gonna get this birdie. And these should be nice, easy tap-ins with a great, great crowd. You know, tell me about playing with this kind of crowd. It's a lot of fun.
Yeah, for me personally, it's super. It's giving me an extra push to play well. I enjoy showing off. I like making fun shots, especially when a lot of people are watching. And I think for all those guys down there, it's the same way.
And we definitely have to give it up to Sweden and Finland. Those are the majority of these spectators are going to be from those two countries, and you know they really showed up and represented the sport well. And it was a lot of fun just to be in the atmosphere of the tournament this weekend with that kind of crowd. Hole 17, we're going to throw another big downhill hole, and for an area you know that doesn't seem like it has a lot of elevation on this course, you do carve out these holes where there's just some really nice up and downhill shots. McPeth is gonna unleash one right here. How big is this shot?
I would guess it's probably around a 500, maybe 550 foot shot. Yeah, seems about right. It's downhill. We usually had a little headwind on this one, but not much. It wasn't really windy. So, but that was a pretty impressive shot. I've actually played the third round with David Wiggins, and he actually threw right past the basket and had a 30-footer backwards for eagle. But it's definitely one of the easier par fours here, and for all the pros, a must-get.
And this is one that I use the term in the first nine, and this is going to be a four-digit separator. You're going to look to eagle it. The pros are going to play it as a par three, and you know amateurs are going to look to play it as a par four because you're going to need that extra distance. The control at that length is, you know, something that comes with the practice that Simon's been talking about.
KJ's disc right there was probably 150 foot shorter than Paul's, and it was actually a perfect drive on this hole. Paul's was just ridiculously far.
Yeah, KJ has that controlled game. He really has been sticking to the plan. You know, it looks like that's where he wanted to place the disc, that going for the eagle was never in his mind. He took the same tactic on the island in hole 6, where he laid up, pitched across, and tapped in for a 3. It's a great example of somebody sticking to their game plan no matter what the scoreboard says, and you know, working it out for the best. Definitely taking second in a major. By now, it's not a spoiler. It's respectable. And to come out and play your game and battle against about 150 other people out there, you know, you got to take your hat off to him for the way he played this weekend. That said, Paul is looking at an eagle putt here on 17. And he just leaves it a little bit short.
Yeah, Paul got this one in the second round. He eagled it from, I think it was probably about the same spot, maybe a little even further away.
And right now, he is on pace to shoot the course record. So, and that's with missing the eagle putt. So you think if he makes an eagle putt, you know, is this course too easy at that point? Do they need to make this harder?
Yeah, that's a good question. I don't think if there's anything you could make harder for Paul sometimes. Just some days, everything looks so easy. And if you know this game, if you play yourself, then you know it's not as easy as it looks.
Definitely has a way of making it look easy. That's really well said. And this is a hole. This is reminiscent of USDGC. You're going to finish. 18 is a tough, uphill, sloped fairway par 4.
Boom.
Paul's going to unload on this one. And that's a great carry. When you see that carry, you know you got a smile. You're getting some extra distance. And then this happens.
Watching this was so unbelievable.
After the round, Paul said, "I'm pretty sure it rolled longer than it was in the air." And you can hear him laughing because this is just utter disbelief.
Rolls out of bounds.
That's crazy. And he does have a lead. He does have a cushion. But, man, you just hate to see that happen on the last hole. And Nate's going to throw it nice and low. This is a more controlled shot right here.
But still, you know, everyone who knows Nate can throw. And look where Paul's landed, where Nate's landed. Paul crushed that drive.
And that's just what happens when he goes into beast mode. You know, I've said of his game before that he's not known as one of the longer arms on tour. He doesn't have that big gun reputation, but, you know, when you watch him throw this round, he's proven me wrong. You know, every time you see him, he's just getting more and more distance on these shots, and with that accuracy that he's known for, it's pretty incredible to watch. Another big gun himself, Ricky Wasaki. And that's where you want to be.
Yeah, similar shot to Paul, just without like a 300-foot roll down the hill. Pretty nice.
And KJ, after unfortunately sawing off that first drive, he's going to take a Spikeheiser here. And is that the play when you're down on the right side?
I've never been right there, actually, so I don't really know what the play is from there. I think he tried to get a 4 from there somehow, and that was probably the only way to get up there.
And I would imagine if you do find yourself down there that knowing how you throw a Spikeheiser would probably be what you're going for. And Nate's going to put a nice intermediate hyzer right up near the green. That should putt. Ricky should putt as well, making this hole look easy. And looks like these guys are going to work to not have any pars on this card. You've got Ricky and Nate are going to have putts for 3, and you know, KJ and Paul are going to look at bogey putts. And it looks like the weather's just holding off. It's trying to rain on us. The weather's been so good, and I've been really happy as the cameraman, knowing that finally we didn't have a major in NT that just dumped on us, yep. You know, like it did in Memorial, like it did in Texas, like it did in Japan. And Nate Doss finishing up right there. Great tournament for him. Set the course record on Saturday. If only for a day, he still had the course record.
Yeah, the weather was really, really nice, and the course, the condition was top-notch, maybe the best I've ever seen the course. And yeah, KJ taking second. I was super proud of him that he played so well. I've known him probably since 10 years, and yeah, Paul was just unbeatable.
And it's definitely great seeing these cameras, seeing the future of the sport start to unfold before our eyes. Any final thoughts for us, Simon?
Yeah, for sure. Just watching Paul here, he's so glad to win, and all these cameras around him, all the gallery around him, and everybody's just appreciating what Disclinia, what Innova, and what UC has done for this tournament right here. And for me, it was a goosebump moment watching this entire tournament. Great experience once again, and yeah.
fantastic on all counts. Thank you so much for stopping by. We started in Texas. We're going to keep this train rolling, have people like you come in and just give us some awesome thoughts on everything that's going on. We hope to see you up there real soon in front of those cameras yourself, buddy. Till next time, I'm Jamie Thomas, Simon Lazat. Keep it locked to Spin TV.